give you the mind of the Lord and where we are in just a second. But what was the scripture? Oh, of course. Yeshua says, truthfully, truthfully, I say unto you, again, he that teaches my word and my commandments and teaches other people to keep them are great in his kingdom. He that says they're not important, I'm just going to live a life of faith, none of that matters, whatever, is least in his kingdom. He means exactly what he says. So we have to look and see what the commandments of God are, because there's a blessing in them. There's a great blessing in every commandment. Because you know what? You ready? God is inseparable of his commandments. They're not two separate entities. God cannot be compartmentalized. Did you understand that? He's holistic God. He's holistic God. When we say the Shema like we did earlier, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad, that the oneness of God is God in the many forms. He's as the menorah, he's the light of the world. As the Ark of the Covenant, he is the very presence of God seated on the mercy seat, right? He is ever living to make intercession for you with the incense that comes up on the altar, right? Your prayers go right now as we're talking. Every time you intercede, guess where they go? Up to heaven, because it says there's an altar of incense, and it says that God and the angels are receiving all that intercession because he's as a high priest. Because remember, it speaks about him all throughout the first covenant, the ancient scriptures. It says that the priesthood and the monarchy, he will be a king and a priest forever and ever on David's throne, right? Think about that. So he's coming back to take David's throne as king, but right now he is the high priest. But I wanted to, you know, we did the song about, you know, I will say yes to you, God. I will say yes to you, okay? But this is your part, and how you say yes to him will determine your placement, let's just say that, where you're going to sit. And I know what I'm talking about, and you'll understand when I get done. I want to talk to you about the one new man, and I'm going to just kind of go fast because I'm going to cover three chapters really quickly. But fasten your seatbelt and put your hat on your head, because if you have, you might want to take notes or you want to record it, whatever. Oh, yes. Okay, very good. Okay. I'm going to start right here in Romans. This is it's called, to any theological expositor, it's called we would call it the dispensational scriptures. In other words, Rabbi Apostle Paul is talking all throughout Romans about justification by faith and about, you know, it's not by the works of the law that we're saved. He's going into, you know, nothing can separate us from the love of God, right? Book of Romans. Okay, then out of nowhere, out of cyberspace, he comes right into chapters 9, 10, and 11. And he's talking to you Gentiles. He's telling you exactly your office before God as the children of Zion. And he says this. It's not that. He says, it's not only that, but Rebekah, who had twins from one conception by Isaac, our father, although they were not yet born, and not either one of them had done any good or evil, but that the plan of God would remain according to the chosen purpose of God, not because of works, but the calling, for it was said that the older will serve the younger. Then God says, I have loved Jacob and hated Esau. So hated doesn't really mean he hates Esau. It just means that Esau gave God no honor, so God dealt very, very, very differently with the Edomites than he did Isaac's seed. So as you honor the covenant of God and love the covenants and recognize that you're the children of Israel and you are partakers of Yisrael's covenants, see, when Yeshua had the Passover and he drank the cups, he says, I am renewing the covenant with the house of Israel and Judah. That's the covenant you drink from. That's who you are. You are children of Israel. But Esau gave no respect to that. So then it says, is there any injustice to God? May it never be. Meganito in Greek, meaning perish the thought. For he said to Moses, I will be merciful to whoever I'll be merciful. I will have compassion on whoever I will have compassion. So then, it is not desire, it's not your effort, it's the mercy of God. Amen. For what does the scripture say to Pharaoh? He says, I raised you up, Pharaoh, for this reason, that I could show my power in you, and my great glorious name would be proclaimed throughout the whole earth. So then it says, it ends by saying, well, so then he's merciful on whom he chooses to be, and he hardens the heart on whom he chooses. Now listen very, very careful. God is so just and so perfect. When God says in the English, in the King James, you know, the King James scriptures, which most of you have, it says that he hardened Pharaoh's heart. Would that be merciful if he didn't harden Pharaoh's heart? And that doesn't sound right, does it? You read it and you say, well, I don't understand why God would do that. But what that really means in the Koine Greek is that Pharaoh was already hard. He was already contentious to do the will of God. He had already set his heart as a stone. So God just hardened it a little more, knowing there was going to be no repentance. And just know that measure by measure, everything with God. Now listen very carefully. According to the Abrahamic covenant, in Genesis 12:3, it says, I will bless you who bless Israel. I will curse you if you curse Israel. What does that mean? That means to the exact degree that you choose to bless Israel and be one with her, God will bless you in your life according to the Abrahamic covenant. To the degree that you lightly esteem the Jewish people and just say, oh, it's not important, you know, I'm, you know, whatever. He says, if you lightly esteem, it's the same thing as cursing. It's a lightly esteeming, diminishing who they are in their purpose before God. Then there's a curse there. And you could look all throughout the history. Does anybody have any books on the subject where God deals with nations and individuals who lightly esteem Israel? He deals really, really heavily with them because the Abrahamic covenant is in full force throughout eternity. Amen. Yeah, it's a staggering thought. And not many people may teach you that, but this is one point you definitely want to get right. So then it says right here, it says, O man, O sinful man, who are you that you should talk back to God and say to the one that's molding, why did you make me like this? Or why, or does the potter not have authority over the clay to make from one lump a vessel of honor and on the other hand, one for dishonor? See, you position yourself to be a vessel of honor or dishonor. God doesn't do that to you. You make choices. See, that's the amazing thing about God. He's so sovereign. What? You really choose, and you will live with your choices, good or bad. Whether you live a life of repentance or whether you live a life of disobedience, you will live with those results on a moment-by-moment basis. Did you understand that? God is grace. God is perfection. God loves you, but in his sovereignty, everybody has free will. If it was not so, he would have not allowed Lucifer, the original sinner, to sin in a perfect heaven. So if he allowed Lucifer to sin in a perfect heaven, where do you think that leaves you? You definitely have free will. If Lucifer did, in a glory, in the realms of glory. So you want to be careful with every choice that you make. God says, I shall call those who are not my people, my people, that's you. And she who has not been loved, my beloved. And it says, and in the place which he spoke, you who are not my people, that's you. You shall now be called children of the living God. That's Hosea 1:10. And God even says, and we talked about this earlier, he says, yet shall the number of the children of Israel be as the sand on the seashores, which cannot be measured. Well, you're part of Israel, so that's millions and millions and millions of precious ones born among the nations that are joined to Israel that were once not the people of God. Remember, you were an alien. Remember, you were not part of the commonwealth. But now you've been brought near. And now you are a partaker. Now you are engrafted into the olive tree. Now you are one with the covenants. Now you are one with the people. Now you are one with the burden and the purposes of God. Isn't that exciting? Amen. You're one with the purposes of God. So Isaiah, and then here we go, Isaiah cries out on behalf of Israel. He says, though to her the number of all the children of Israel is as the sand of the sea, only a remnant will be saved. Well, that's true. Only a remnant's going to receive their Messiah. But isn't that true about Gentiles? Only a remnant of Gentiles are going to get saved too. Not every Gentile. I mean, this false gospel stuff that God loves everybody and everybody's saved and one day the devil's going to get saved. Has anybody heard this wacky teaching? Oh, it's getting worse and worse and worse. Because if you're going to talk about the love of God, that's what he is love. But let's talk about all of his other faces. He is consummate love. His substance is love itself. But he has justice and judgment. If he didn't, there'd be no hell. Correct? That nobody would go there. You know? But there's judgment and judgment that come out from the love of God. And so we have to warn people. Part of giving the gospel of the love of Yeshua is to warn them. Right? We've got to warn sinners to be, because we're not atoned for and the blood is not on the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant on our behalf. They're not going to be with the Lord. So I want you to hear what the apostle says. He says, my brothers, remember he's talking to the saved among the nations, the desire of my heart and my deepest prayer to God concerning Israel is on behalf of their salvation. If you can follow along this Romans 10:1, he says, "For I bear witness to them because they have a great zeal for God, but not according to the knowledge, because they did not know the righteousness of God, but sought to make their own righteousness, and they have not submitted to the righteousness of God. Because the purpose of the Torah is Messiah, to provide righteousness for everyone who believes." So righteousness absolutely does come by faith. The word is near you. It's deep into your heart. So then here we go. This is your portion. How will they call upon the Messiah? How will they call upon whom they did not believe? How can they believe if no one's told them and they don't hear? How can they hear without a preacher? How can they preach unless they would send the preachers? For as it is written, how beautiful are your feet to those who bring the good news of the gospel to Israel. It says, but they did not obey the one preaching the good news because now this is wonderful for you. Boy, this is the best thing in the world. Because it says, Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? That's Isaiah 53. He says, who has believed it? So faith is by hearing the message. The voice went throughout all the earth. Then I say, didn't Israel not understand? But Moses says, I will provoke you, Israel, to jealousy by those nations and those people who were not a nation, by a foolish nation who doesn't keep my Torah, I will make you angry. So God says, I've held out my hands all day long to a disobedient people. Well, that's Israel. Israel's been disobedient. But this is where you come in. So therefore I say, did God ever reject his people? Mego ito, may it never be. Perish the thought. For I myself am an Israeli, the seed of Abraham, the tribe of Benjamin. He did not reject his people, whom he already foreknew. And don't you know what Elijah said? Lord, they've killed all your prophets and tore down all your altars. I'm the only one left. He said, no, what does that say? I've reserved 7,000. So when you think there's only a few of them, there's a lot more who did not bend their knee to that false god Baal. So it says there's a remnant right now at this present time according to the election of grace. Now this is wonderful because it says here that the Israel, only the remnant sought the Lord, and the rest were callous, because it says God himself, listen to this very carefully, gave them, the Jewish people, a spirit of stupor that they could not see and that they could not hear until this very day. Now, and then David says that their table has to become a snare and a trap and a stumbling block. Their eyes have to be darkened. This is Psalm 69. And they have to bend their back backwards. He says that he had to do that because Gentiles, those born among the nations, you don't have a covenant with God. The only way you could be saved is if Israel got sidetracked. Do you understand? If Israel didn't have any stupor or something, there was no plan to go in. But see, God's foreknowledge, he loves you like he loves Israel.
Right.
It's the same great love for you sons and daughters. He had to make sure. So he literally put that on Israel so that you could come into Israel's covenant. That's the word of the Lord. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
That's so glorious. Their eyes that they couldn't see. So it says, so Apostle Paul says, did they stumble? Did the Jews stumble that they would just fall down forever? There it is, God forbid. But by their transgression, this salvation has now come to you Gentiles, because your office is to provoke them to jealousy. So the question is, how do you provoke a Jew? Because see, when you stand before Yeshua, he's coming back soon, and he's going to wonder where his family is and how you interceded to bring his family back to him. Because he cares a lot about his brothers and sisters of his own race. You understand? You know ethnicities. You know how you fight for the whites and the blacks and the Jews and the Asians and this and that. You kind of take a stand if somebody gets, you know, not right with your people. Well, how much more a holy God with his people who rejected him as a nation, right? So your office, because they first gave you the gospel and the truth of Yeshua, is to give it back to them and provoke them to jealousy. Now, I have to tell you, provoking them to jealousy is a hard work, and I'll tell you why. When you bring the true gospel of Yeshua, the atonement to our people Israel, and you pray hard for them and you intercede and say, oh, God, save your family, that's a hard work. You're a major target of the devil, number one, because it's through the Jew that he returns. You have to understand, it's not the last Gentile that says, God, please save me. It's the when Yeshua returns, it's the last Jew who says, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes. And that's, O Judah, O Jerusalem. He's talking about the Jews. When the last Jew says, Baruch haba, it's all over. He comes back to the Mount of Olives. So guess what? Satan don't want you doing your mandate. No, don't provoke the Jews, because he knows when that last Jew says Baruch haba, it's all over. And his time frame is done, because Satan's on a leash. You understand that? He's on a leash. He's on a time frame. He only has a certain time frame to work. And see, when you, as a precious bride of the Lamb, when you do that office and you pray them into the kingdom, you're really praying back a quick return for the Lord. You could exponentially possibly make the prophetic word come to pass, maybe a little bit more. Do you understand? That you don't hear these messages too much, and why do you think that is? Because Satan don't want any of the saved to ever hear any of this. Oh, no, don't talk about the one new man. Oh, no, please don't open your mouth again about the Jews getting saved and Israel, and you're really part of her and your children and you're the younger brothers and sisters of Zion. Oh, don't do that, because that one thing you do, that one thing I'm talking about, is what brings the Messiah back. Isn't that exciting? Amen. Okay, so it says, now this, hear this. He says, that have they stumbled forever, God forgive, but because of their transgression and not seeing and hearing and stumbling over the stumbling rock, it says that because they did that, it is riches, their transgression is riches. If their transgression is riches for all the saved Gentiles and their loss riches for you, how much more will their coming to the Messiah, their fulfillment be greater riches? So you want to have the knowledge of God. You want to have the revelation. You want to be the most supremely blessed, saved among the nations. Bring the Jewish people, because it's your spiritual riches and your natural riches for all eternity. That's deep. You ever heard that? Anybody ever heard this? This is kind of new to you. It's the truth. It's powerful. So then he says, then Apostle Paul, he says, I'm speaking to you Gentiles. He says, because I am the apostle to the Gentiles. He says, I honor my ministry. If I could just provoke my flesh to jealousy, if I could just rescue some of them. Then he says, if their rejection of the Messiah is actually the reconciliation of the whole world. Now listen, because the Jews rejected the Messiah, it literally means that you could come in and the whole world is reconciled. Is that deep? The whole world is reconciled. The reconciliation of the whole world, that's a big plan. It says, what is their acceptance going to be by God, but literally resurrection life from the dead? Okay, now listen, the commonwealth, the ecclesia, the saved among the nations, whatever terminology you want to use, church, ecclesia, all those words, you're saved among the nations. If, think about this, you have the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We watched them in action today, didn't we? Boy, people were delivered. People worship. People know God, right? They know God. But the plan and the purpose of God, now listen to this, this is deep. But you are so gifted with the word of knowledge and of understanding and prophecy and apostolic and healing. Actually, Rabbi Paul says, yes, to build up the body, but it's fundamentally to bring the Jewish people to salvation, because they're a signs and a wonder people. Because he said you're what? He said you love knowledge. He says Gentiles love to know everything, but the Jews require a sign. Well, guess what? I'm the only Jew here. If we had about 50 Jews this afternoon, they'd all be saved. If they watched all these deliverances, I watched them myself. I prayed over them. I was like, oh, if only we had God's family, the Jewish brothers and sisters here to see this, they'd say, Yeshua is the Messiah. Amen. Look at how they're being delivered. A demonstration in power. So you have been given that gift to literally lay hands and say, Yeshua HaMashiach, he is your Messiah. And then speak prophetically to them like you do, and say, you know, a word of prophecy. I know that you're sad that your mother died last year, but God wants you to know that he's your father and he will provide. You know, like that. Whoa, words of knowledge. They respond to that because they're signs and wonders people. That's what they know. You see? Very, very, very powerful. So Rabbi Paul, apostle, was completely, he went to the Jew first because that's the order of God. But he literally, his ministry was what? To train and teach the nations exactly what I'm saying. If Rabbi Paul was here in the flesh, he would not say anything different to you than what I'm saying right now. He would say, imitate me as I imitate the Messiah. No different of a message, you know? So he says, so if I can just provoke them, he says, and if the first fruits are holy, what's the first fruit? Means the remnant of Israel that have received the Messiah. He says, then the whole batch, meaning national Israel is holy because the root is holy, so are the branches. So then you say, now here, I'm just quoting scripture, but this is how you talk. Listen carefully. This is your speech. This is what you say. But if some of the branches were broken off, right, you're broken, and you're a wild olive branch, you're grafted in amongst them, then you would be a participant of the richness and the fatness of the root of the olive tree. Because, see, your national life in the covenants of who God is found in national Israel. Your gifting, it comes from Israel. Because Israel gave you the signs and the wonders. See, this is from the beginning. See, it's been off track for a long time. We've been off track so long. But God's bringing it back to the beginning. Isn't that beautiful? So then Rabbi Paul says, stop boasting, O Gentile branches. Because if you boast, you do not support the root. But the root is supporting you. Israel is supporting you. But then he says, but then you're going to speak and say, but the branches of the olive tree are broken off so I could be grafted in. Right. Okay? He says, yes, that's true. They're broken off by unbelief, but you just stand by faith. Do not be haughty and boastful, but you must continually fear for yourself. For if God, who did not spare the natural branches, he will in no way spare you. What does that mean? Doesn't mean you go to hell. It just means that your service to God is limited. Because you have to see the connection and the oneness you have with Israel and your love for your older brother. You see? You can't say, oh, look at them, they didn't believe and I'm in their place now. Correct? No replacement. No. Everybody's in their position. There's no supremacy here. It's just a position we're talking about. He says he will not spare you either. Then it says, behold, the goodness of God and the severity. On one hand, severity, those who fell. On the other hand, the goodness of God. If you will remain in the goodness of God, otherwise God will cut you off. Now, I'm not making this up, folks. This is Rabbi Paul, the pure word of the Lord. What does he mean he will cut you off? If your spirit is haughty and not right and think that you're your own entity apart from Israel and you're doing your own thing, then you're cut off in your service. That's really huge, because we're talking about going to the Bema, meeting Yeshua. Oh, this is big. This is, you know, you can't come back and do it again, folks. There's no one, there's no other teacher, there's no other church you're going to go to or teaching or whatever. You're coming through and then you're going to end, like the dear brother said. People die like crazy. In a moment's time, they're gone. So you got one shot. You can only take with you what you did in your one life here before Yeshua. You only got one shot. So, you can't say, well, I didn't hear, I didn't know, and there was no teacher, and blah, blah, blah. Yeshua's going to say, whether it was a teacher or not, he's going to say, I gave you my word. It was pure. You could study, because that's why you have to study to show yourself approved unto God. So, so, so important. At the end, because you know why? Deception is rampant now. Deception, half-truths, mixtures on every theological bias you can imagine. Like we're talking about God is total consummate love, but or we hear that he's justice and judgment. Nobody talks about the love. So, you know, God has, in Hebrew, when it talks about face, it's not a singular word, it's plural. Everything in Hebrew has a lot of plurality to it because, remember, he's the plurality of the singular unit. He's one. He's one, but he has many, many, many forms. He's the angel of the Lord. He's the temple menorah. He's right. He's the high priest. He's the creator. He's the lion of Judah. He's a multiplicity of things. So we have to understand the oneness of God. So it ends by saying this. So therefore, dear brothers, born of the nations, do not be ignorant of this huge mystery, because you will become conceited and dull in your perception, because in part Israel has become blind until all the fullness of the Gentiles come into the fold. So there's a partial blindness. Now, people like me who've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb since a very, very young child, there's a remnant also. But the fact is that it's very easy to be in your own world and not think about Israel, not think about, but you get dull in your perception. You don't think you are, but you've lost your edge because you're off in that area. It says, but the fact of the matter is God's waiting for the times of the Gentiles, right? The times of the Gentiles have to be fulfilled. And then what happens? Then the kingdom comes. And it says, in this, I need some water. Well, he's got it. Yeah, right here, Pastor John. Well, Lord, give me my voice here. It says, this is the capstone here. It says that only when the fullness of the Gentiles come in, he totally turns his attention back to Israel. And then Yeshua's ears wait for the last Yehudi, the last Jew, to say Baruch Haba, and he returns. That's the master plan of God. And so it says, and in this particular way, then all Israel will be saved. For as it is written, the one who rescues will come from Zion. He will turn away all ungodliness from Jacob, because this is my covenant with them, the covenants with Israel, when I take away all their sins. So that what that means is, in this way, well, in what way? What is the Apostle Paul saying? In this way that all Israel will be saved. Meaning this, in this way, he's just giving you a totally didactic teaching on the plan and the purpose for God for the redeemed and what it's going to look like at the end of the age. In this way, meaning at the beginning, when the ecclesia was first formed and the one new man was first formed 2,000 years ago, we had the Jewish witness that brought the gospel, Pentecost, Shavuot, right? Yeah. Right? And then 3,000 were saved. We're all Jews. And just the remnant of Gentiles came into the fold of Israel in the first century before things got really contaminated, right? And so in this way, as the same way that the first initial Gentiles were saved and part of the body, he's saying, now it's your turn, because it's the end of the age. See, we're coming down the runway. At the end of the age, in this way, when you provoke the Jew to jealousy, when you intercede for them to come to know Yeshua, when you learn the Torah and you could bring any Jew to the Messiah, you don't even have to go to the new covenant, because everything in the first covenant is Yeshua. It all speaks about him. The story of Joseph, I mean, every single thing, you know, Isaiah 53, the atonement. Learn the two-thirds on the left so you can witness to your Jewish brothers and sisters to come into the truth of God. Because in this way, all Israel will be saved. The entire redemptive plan of God will be completed through you doing your mandate. And just like Ruth of old, sticking with Naomi, sticking with Israel, you know, there's Rahab with the two spies, right? She's in the genealogy of Yeshua. Wow, Rahab the harlot? Wow, that's amazing. And Ruth the Moabitess. The Moabites that were cursed to 10 generations could not even come into the camp of Israel. God picks a Moabitess. So he's going to pick you, because you're not trying to be a big deal. You're in the house of the Lord. You're at a convocation. You want to worship and praise God. He's going to pick unlikely people that are humble and lowly, who will recognize, like you said earlier, when the Syrophoenician woman came to Yeshua, when he walked the earth, he said, heal my daughter. He says, don't you know I'm only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel? Oh, but Master Rabboni, don't you know that even the dogs will eat the crumbs at the bottom of the table? And then he said, oh, Master said, well, okay, I've got a live one here. Okay, bring her forth. I want to heal her. Okay, but why did he heal her? Because of what she said. She knew her position. She knew he was sent to Israel. She knew she wasn't redeemed yet, but she was still honoring him. Guess what she did? She acted like a Jew. She bowed down because in Hebrew, when you come before a rabbi and you come before a great one, and of course he's Yeshua, you show respect. Just like the Asians, you do that, okay? So she went as a Syrophoenician, and she gave honor to him as God, and she was prostrate. See, she raised her hands, and she went down, and then he healed her, because it's what you do. She's great as your faith. Wow, you act like one of my, you act like a person of the covenant, see? So you have to be people of the covenant. You can't just do your own thing. So at the end of the age, this mandate to love, in this way, all Israel will be saved. In this way, the last Yehudi will come to Yeshua. And in this way, you'll be able to give our Yeshua a beautiful silver platter. Say, here's your family, Master. I did the mandate that you told me to. I brought your family to you. You understand how important that is to him? I mean, look, can I tell you something? Everybody loves their mother and father, sister, brother, because that's your family. And they could be not so great and have a lot of problems, right? And maybe to you, you were abused and this and that, but it's still, they're part of you. So how much greater God with his family? Amen. See, because all the way down through the ages, it's still the Jewish people that have this, that he loves, that he wants to bring into the fold, and he's giving you that work. Because guess what? Nobody else is going to do it. Right. Nobody else. Everybody hates the Jews, folks, because it's a satanically, diabolically inspired hatred. It's not natural hatred. He hates them more than he hates anybody. He hates the Jews, and then the Christians are right on the dovetail. You understand? You're right there. You're right next to them. You dovetail the Jew, I'm telling you right now. But the fact of the matter is he specifically hates Jews and those who are partner with them and those who bring them to their God. So his mandate, according to the scripture, and thus all Israel would be saved, is will you do what the word of the Lord has told you to do? And I want to apostolically have everybody who is willing to do that, I want to say a blessing, that you will be able to give Yeshua HaMashiach a silver platter of his people, whether you meet them and you put your hands on their shoulder and say, Yeshua is your Messiah, and you study the Torah as you should already, to bring them into a knowledge of God through the writings in the Torah. This kind of work, and your wonderful deliverances, and your signs and wonders, and your prophetic everything. You know, like I said, if you get around one, ask God for a word of prophecy about them. Look for the Goldmans and the silversmiths, you know, and these kind of names. Because when you go to them, they will know. You will provoke them to jealousy. You will make them so angry with you because they will be so angry that you are operating in what they should be operating in. See, the Jewish people aren't supposed to know God and give God to the nations of the world, but everything's turned upside down. They rejected the humble twig. So now it's been given to you to bring them back to God. And in this way, so shall Israel be saved. Amen. Glory to God. Stand up. Let me get, give me my horn. Amen. Everybody who wants to give Yeshua a silver platter on the day you meet him with his family, stand, okay? And I'm going to first say a blessing, and then I'm going to blow my horn, and then for God to seal it, to seal it. Father, okay. Father, I thank and I praise you for your rich eternal word, and for everyone standing, Lord, that is in a receptacle mode of receiving for you, Lord. I pray that you anoint and impart unto every person here, that's your beautiful bride, your beautiful sons and daughters of Zion who are one with you, Lord, that they would do the office and the mandate of loving them, bringing them in through their intercession, showing them and demonstrating the signs and the wonders to provoke them to anger only so that they would come to know you. They will be red hot mad, so much so that they will be, it will drive them to their knees. And it's your plan and your purpose to work that way, Lord. So I thank you for each one here that's standing, that they would be able to give you your family on the day that they stand before you, Lord. Whether they're in the ground or whether they're alive and remaining for your return, Father. I pray that you would seal this with the shofar and that they would just be, you would show mercy to them and bring your people to them. They can run after them, but I'm also asking you to bring your family to them so they will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you in the highest heaven, in the supreme seat, has brought your family to them to witness to them in Yeshua's name. Okay, Stan, I'm going to blow so far. Congratulations, Mazel Tov.